So today we will we are very excited about having Dr. Ernest Morrell come speak with us. But before we will have that, Gail Hyinga will be up in a moment to deal with some weather announcements. But yeah, we need. Keep your fingers crossed. So then we will have. So he will be speaking for about an hour. Then we have a Q&A. Again, we will have a short break before our teacher panel. The literacy leaders is actually our panel for this afternoon, and our breakout sessions. Gail?
Thanks. I'm sorry to give you this news, but yes, we still are expecting some weather this afternoon. In case things get a little crazy and the weather is, you know, becomes worse than we all hope it will be, I want to tell you where the shelters are. And so for the most part, we can go out these doors back here, if you're in this room, and even in this room next to us. Out these doors, this hallway is a tornado shelter. Where the restrooms are in this hallway is a tornado shelter. The classrooms on the first floor here, as you go north, if you stay towards this area, away from the windows, that also is a tornado shelter area. My feeling is if we all go back here into this hallway, we'll be fine. They also said that if the folks are in west room, you could go to the far wall and you also would be protected. There are no windows, and although these are movable walls, they are strong, and they feel that you would be safe in there too. So does anybody have any questions? I will be watching the weather and talking with the on-campus police, so we'll keep you updated with if anything arises, okay? Thank you. Oh, if there is a lot of lightning, I will let you know so you can power down. I wouldn't want you guys to lose your computers and things like that, so, okay.
Power surge protectors, yay. With that news, as not happy as it is, that's the idea. If we're prepared, it doesn't happen. I like that idea. Dr. Ernest Morrell is a professor of education and the director of the Institute for Urban and Minority Education at Teachers College, Columbia University in New York. He's a writer of poems, plays, essays, novels, as well as academic books, chapters, articles, reviews. For more than a decade, he's worked with adolescents, drawing on their involvement with popular culture to promote academic literacy development. He is the current president for the National Council of Teachers of English. In addition to, he is the author of multiple books, including Critical Literacy and Urban Youth, Linking Literacy and Popular Culture, Finding Connections for Lifelong Learning, and Becoming Critical Researchers, Literacy for Empowerment for Urban Youth. It is our utmost pleasure, so please join me with a round of applause to welcome Dr. Ernest Morrell.
Scary. All right, there we are. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, that was great. Everyone's wide awake and happy summer. Hopefully we'll stay dry inside. We're still not in summer. We have sandy days in New York. So when I go back, we have a couple more weeks of school. One school ends on the 24th, one ends on the 27th. So kids are going almost up to the 4th of July. So enjoy June. We won't be. It's such a pleasure to be here to talk about the work that I've been doing. You know, a little bit of background. This is the end of my 20th year in education. And I've taught everything from middle school up to college, graduate school. More recently, at Teachers College, I'm a professor in the English Education Department. I'm also president-elect of NCTE, and I run an institute there at Columbia University. And we've been doing a lot of work with schools. I work with schools across the country, but this year, I've really been focusing on schools in the New York and New Jersey area. So we're definitely, as we end the year, I feel like we're going into year two of the Common Core rollout. So I can talk about what we've been doing, the schools, and what I feel has been really successful work, both in terms of how teachers are planning, but also the kind of things that are in the classroom. I will just say, you know, as a disclaimer before, what we're finding is very powerful teaching that is socially, culturally, and technologically relevant for young kids and that gets them excited about learning transcends the standards, any standards document. The kids are performing, so it's not necessarily reinventing the kinds of things that we're doing to conform to the standards. It's thinking about how to engage students, how to have that relevant and rigorous instruction, and at the same time, how to make reasonable changes in what literacy instruction should look like, given that the world is rapidly changing. So that's kind of where the title comes from, Powerful Literacy Teaching for the 21st Century Classroom. Because the classroom is about preparing kids for the world. So as the world changes, what happens in the classrooms needs to change as well. And so I'll start with this idea of 21st century learning, right? Or 21st century classrooms. When we say that, what do we mean by that? So this is a picture of an American factory about 100 years ago, right? And so I'll show this picture to kids, and I've shown it to teachers all over. I ask them what it looks like, and what does it look like? A classroom. So many of you that are historians of education, you might know that when public schools were created in the United States, and this was a revolutionary moment because in most of human history prior, the average person was not educated. Education was just reserved for very, very wealthy, a small group. So it's really only been a little more than a century where we tried to educate everyone. So public schools, industrial schools, came about at the same time that this was what the workplace looked like. And the skill set that you needed to be successful in this kind of a world, you needed to be able to read directions, follow directions, work quietly and independently at a desk for hours at a time. So it makes sense that when they design schools around this model of the factory, right? Even bells releasing you between classrooms. So I'm not critiquing this model at all. It was very effective in moving from an agrarian economy to an industrial economy in less than a century, right? It's done wonders for us so that, you know, the literacy levels in most industrial countries now are 99%. Right? So this model of schooling has worked well for us when this was the model of work. The 20th century classroom made a lot of sense. So 20th century schools were designed for the 20th century life. Right? So, but we think about where we are now and this idea of the 21st century, right? If we were going to work backwards from the world that our kids will inhabit, and how many kindergarten teachers? So, guess what, teachers? Your students are going to live to see the 22nd century. The 22nd century, right? Kids that are in kindergarten today are going to be mid-career in 2050. They'll probably retire somewhere around 2080, right? And they'll be out on a golf course in Florida the 22nd century. So, this kind of schooling may not work for them. Right? So if we think about, well, how has the world changed in the last 100 years? And how might we need to think about what literacy is differently, what literacy instruction is differently, what teachers do with students differently, as a natural growth of our profession? Right? It's not about something being broken and fixing. It's just, what's the natural growth? What's the continual development of literacy instruction look like, given its adaptation to the changing world? So, real quick, just hands and shout-outs. What are things that you notice about these pictures that are different than the first two that I showed? Okay, so I'm hearing about technology. Just shout it out. Interaction, collaboration. Yes, the kids always point to that. They are happy, right? They look much happier than those women in the sewing factory, for sure. What I say is they're engaged, right? The kids will talk about there's diversity, age diversity, gender diversity, ethnic diversity, right? And that there's multiple ways of communicating and multiple workspaces. So the mom is at home on the phone, on the computer with her daughter, right? In the meetings, you have people, and they're using technology, and they may be looking at someone on the screen. They may have different people Google chatting or Skyping on their screens, right? So it's a very different kind of world, right? You see the designs are more like your tables, right? They're designed for interaction, whereas the designs in the 20th century classrooms were largely straightforward, and they were kind of, there was a focal point of the classroom, right? Where this is different. So we think about what it means to kind of be at work, to be at play, and what kind of implications they should have for how we teach, what we teach, how we redefine literacy. When I think of the movement that we're in, and the standards are just a small part of it, the logical part to me is that the world is changing, the demands from industry, social life, college are changing, right? And as those demands are changing, we need a different kind of student, right? So we're being pushed to think differently, not because we've done anything wrong, but because the world is evolving and we need to evolve with it. So I like to start with that, and not the crisis language, the problem language, but just the development. What does it mean to continue in this natural development? We're still in this experiment of public schooling. We're just entering our second century of doing this kind of stuff. So with that in mind, you know, in the work that I've been doing, certainly, we want to raise achievement, and I've been fortunate enough to work in a lot of schools where we've raised achievement to high levels, and I'll talk about a couple of those stories later on. But I generally start with three questions, right? Because we can't start with the question, how do I raise achievement? It's way too abstract, or how do I conform to these standards? It's way too abstract. We ask three questions about how we do what we do and why we do what we do that center the conversation. We do a lot of collaborative planning with teacher teams, a lot of sharing of lessons, looking at what evidence can we find of student learning that's formative in addition to just the high-stakes assessment. So the first question we ask is, how do we get students excited about learning? And I can't say this enough. Excited students raises achievement. It raises achievement. I can go into a classroom where four teachers have co-planned, and the level of engagement and excitement will be directly correlated to the production and learning in the classroom. Excited students are engaged, right? Engaged students are more productive, right? More productive students are learning, and they feel better about themselves. So one of our questions is not necessarily just how do we conform to standards, but how do we get kids excited about what they're doing? And I'll talk more about this throughout my talk, but we have to understand the logic of why they're not excited. You know, I'm a teacher, my wife's a teacher, both of my parents were teachers, and her parents were teachers. So, yeah, it's a lot of teaching in the Morrell household. But one of the things my dad would say, and he was an award-winning teacher. My senior year in high school, he was up for an award for the State Teacher of the Year. And he gave an address at his school, and I was there, and he said, we have to understand the logic of student disinvestment, right? Instead of seeing it as pathological. Why are they disengaged? Why are they not excited? Instead of saying it's their fault for being not excited, why are they not excited? So one of the schools I'm working at was listed as one of the top five turnaround schools in the state of New Jersey last year. Same students. The English department is exactly intact. The administration's exactly intact. Same homes, no difference in socioeconomic status. So how do you go from being an underperforming school to one of the top turnaround schools in the state in 1 year? It's student engagement, right? They did not come back to school this fall with new minds. But they did because of the learning cultures that were created. They brought new attitudes. And those attitudes were everything, right? So how do we get them excited? Right, when we think about planning, that's so important. We talk about how do we make it pop, right? The second question, equally important, And this really gets at the logic of disinvestment. How do we get students to believe in themselves? Raising student confidence raises achievement. And we see it a lot. You know, we do surveys of kids, we'll talk to kids. A lot of times, what a kid is manifesting to you is what I cannot do, what I think I cannot do, not what I don't want to do. But it's too painful to say, I don't think I can do it. This is a part of the logic of disinvestment. So we go in and we think about engaging students, and we break that down into a couple different categories. Can't do it, or thinks that they can't do it, doesn't want to do it. Right, and separating the two. So when we go in and change explanations, when we change supports, when we change scaffolds, when we break our macro lessons into micro lessons, when we differentiate, all of a sudden we find out that half, two-thirds of the kids that are perpetually disengaged become engaged. There are all sorts of explanations for why those kids were disengaged while they were disengaged. But what we found is that when they had explanations and when they began to believe in themselves and when they began to believe that they could do the work, far more of them were engaged. So we have to ask this question, how do we do that? Right? I'm convinced in looking at how quickly schools turn around, we don't have an ability crisis in our schools as much as we have an identity crisis. And aspirations across socioeconomic group, across gender, across age, across geographical region in the United States are universally high. Kids want to do well, and they know doing well matters in their life. So we don't have to convince them of that. And sometimes we spend a lot of time trying to convince them that it's important to do well. What we should do instead is convince them that they're important. That's the difference. They know that homework's important. Someone who doesn't do their homework is not going to get a high-paying job. They know that. But what they don't know necessarily is, I can do this if I apply myself, right? So a real question when we think about changing instruction, changing curriculum, is have we put in the right kinds of scaffolds and the right kind of supports so that the majority of students actually can do well and so that they think that they can do well? The third question is, what kind of education does she need? Not necessarily what kind of education am I trained to provide. My youngest son is 18 months old. He can say iPad, but he can't say his brother's names. Right? So we know what generation he's of, right? He can turn a thing on, he can find apps, even hidden apps. He can find them, he can play them, he can get on the internet, he can surf around, do all those sorts of things. He looks about like her. She's one of those 22nd century babies, right? One of those people that's going to enter the workforce sometime around, you know, in the 2030s. Now, you know, I'm dating myself, but I started kindergarten in 1976. I started graduate school in 1992. And so the education that she needs is not necessarily the education I was initially trained to provide, right? And many of you are probably in the same position that I am. So it's been a growth experience and a retraining of myself. If I want to continue to be relevant for this young girl, I have to leave 1976 kindergarten, right? I started graduate school at the University of California. There was no internet. Right now, kids don't even have a word for internet because it's everywhere. So think about that, that part of our responsibility, if we're going to continue to grow with our profession, and we're going to continue to be relevant, is that we have to think more pragmatically about what our kids need from us, even if that means we are being moved in dramatic ways from what we've been trained to do. That we have to be in that continual retraining and improvement of our practice. So, like I said, so a couple of the schools that I work with, this is one of the districts I work with in New Jersey, that in 2012 was one of the top five turnaround schools. I also work with a number of schools in Brooklyn. This particular sub-district, 100% college bound, over 90% graduation rate, and you know, numerous elementary schools that are outperforming the state averages and outperforming their peers. And it's been a really powerful journey working with these teachers in these schools. And so what I want to do, you know, for my short time is share what it is we've been doing and what I think is happening in the changes in literacy instruction K-12. And I think that this addresses directly the question of planning for the Common Core, but in some ways, planning for 21st century literacy instruction, planning to engage and excite students and have them believe in themselves transcends the Common Core standards. Right? And that's the places where I am, and they don't talk about the Common Core as much as they talk about excellence. And a definition of excellence for all students, I believe, in many ways transcends. There's some specific things about the close reading and the writing that I do think are important to pay attention to, but for the most part, you know what excellent literacy instruction looks like. And getting your students there is going to transcend the Common Core standards. So the real question for us is, how do we approach excellence with the majority of our students in this context for learning? So the title of my talk and the way I've been talking about this is Cultivating Youth Voices, right? It's a very different paradigm from the one of the women in the sewing factory, right? Where literacy education for most of public schooling's history has been about consuming information, right? If you could consume the information and regurgitate it, you were going to be fine probably up through undergraduate and college, right? Make note cards, memorize the stuff, and then spit it back on the test in your blue book. But the 21st century is very different, right? Because you're being asked to create knowledge. And so the shift, the huge shift in writing, right? I mean, one thing I've seen differently in the schools in year one of the Common Core is the amount of writing. Even in kindergarten classrooms, the kids are writing first grade. So it's because writing or the production of knowledge is such an important commodity in 21st century. So students need to be able to cultivate multiple voices, right? They need to have the local voice, the family voice, the hang out with my kids voice, the how I speak to the mayor voice, the I need to make a proposal to get grant money voice, and how do we get, you know, the sidewalks paved voice. And so cultivating these voices in authentic moments where kids understand why they're doing it is a great way to build your curriculum, right? How do we make it relevant? How do we center it in projects that are meaningful to kids? Those sorts of things. So, why we do this, how we tap into it. So the first thing is this idea of motivation. And I should say, Mike, the PowerPoint's going to be available to folks? Yeah, so I should have said that before, so you don't have to scribble that. You can have the PowerPoint. You can get it. Mike will tell you how to get it. So the first thing is, how do we tap into kids' natural motivations? Right? And so these schools where they're having this success, kids are motivated to do a lot of things. And if we can connect what they're motivated to do to learning literacy, we have a much better chance of teaching the literacy. They have things they want to say, right? How many times do you hear kids, even the young elementary, it's not fair, right? Fairness matters to them. Justice matters to them, right? Peace matters to them. Not having bullying around matters to them. The environment matters to them. And so we can create projects around, what are you motivated to say? What do you want to say? Knowing how to say it. Right? I mean, that's where the magic of teaching comes in, because kids have all sorts of things that they want to say, but they don't know how to say it. Right? If we get them into that point, they're right in that spot where our expertise comes in. I can help you say what you want to say. Right? This class, we can help you do the kinds of things you want to do. The third we've already talked about, feeling good about your ability to say it. Right? I was in a class in Gary, Indiana, in this first grade class, and the teacher it was writing all over the walls, and they were so serious, and students were presenting to each other, and they were kind of in a semicircle, and I walked in, she's like, hi, Dr. Morrell, we're all writers here. And the kids are like, yeah, we're all writers. I was in an elementary school in Queens, the same thing. First and second grade classes, and the kids had their writers' theater, and they felt good about their identity as writers, and guess what? Both of those schools were overachieving, right? High poverty schools, high achievement schools, kids had that identity as writers. They even talked about that. We talked about creating a culture of writers, not a culture of writing, right? If you think about writing as separate from your identity, it can be this chore. But one of the things is that we begin to, how do we create a culture of writers? Writing is not something I do. A writer is someone I am. And to see kids even at 6, 7 years old begin to embrace those identities, guess what? I mean, they're cultivating a voice as a writer. It becomes a part of how they live. Saying it with power and authority, using my voice to know about myself and others. I hear this time and time again in the social and emotional issues that are really important to teaching literacy that affect not just our kids' ability to perform, but how they feel about themselves, how they feel about others. These are also 21st century skills, not just knowing myself, but understanding that I need to have a skill to be able to empathize and understand people across multiple lines of difference. And I need to have a voice that allows me to do that. But guess what? Even for adults, that comes very difficultly, right? It's not easy. We have to help kids understand how to do that, right? How do I listen? How do I synthesize information? How do I disagree in a way that's agreeable, right? All of those kinds of, how do we create a community where it's okay to have different opinions? We have to continually teach, even at graduate school, I have to teach young people how to do that, right? So definitely in the K-12 spectrum, that has to be part of what cultivating a voice means. Cultivating a voice means, like my grandma says, you have two ears and one mouth for a reason. It means that I have to be able to listen to other voices. It's not just about talking and then shutting off, right? Cultivating my voices means cultivating my listening to other voices, right? Which is a huge shift now in the, you know, in the standards they have these speaking and listening skills, and that because that's an important part of what it means to get on in this new century. Okay, so the one theory slide that I want to have, because I think this is really important, about what motivates people to achieve. Right, and this is research that's been done over the past 40, well, actually closer to 60 years, going back to the 50s. Research on achievement, motivation, and social psychology. This is my favorite of the theories. This is one I found early in my teaching career. It really changed my practice and how I began to focus. So the expectancy value theory of achievement motivation, I know that's a mouthful, but I'll break it down. It's basically two criteria that will determine how motivated your students are to achieve. The first one is the expectation of success. I boil that down to confidence. If I expect success, I will be motivated to achieve. That makes sense when you think about it, right? So it's very difficult for students to be motivated when they don't feel like they can do what you're asking them. You can threaten them, you can call their mom, you can call their dad, you can call their mom and dad and grandma all at the same time, make them put their heads down, sit in the corner with their heads down. It's not gonna motivate them. It could intimidate them, but motivating, they have to be confident that they can do what's asked. The second criteria is relevant, or the value proposition. And I started doing this kind of research in my early 20s, finding very sophisticated cognitive activities that kids were engaged in because it was relevant to them, right? They do all sorts of things that require the same kind of cognitive ability that you're asking in the classroom because things are valuable to them, like learning how to operate tablets and cell phones and program language and HTML and social networking and all sorts of technical things that the students are able to do, even literacy-based activities the students are engaged with because it's valuable to them. So if we want to increase engagement, we have to confront both of these things. How do we increase the expectation of success with more of our students? So I'm thinking, you know, in the number, we know that there's going to have to be a different kind of differentiation for 15-20% of the kids in our class from our normal lessons, right? That number is pretty standard. I go into a class, it's about 4 or 5 kids in a class that you're going to have to plan a lesson, then plan a lesson, right? But of that 20 to 25, what do we need to do to get them fully engaged? First of all, it moves, it decreases the standard deviation on test scores. When you can address that 5 to 10 student that's kind of the variable, the X factor in your class, right? Think about, if I increase their expectation of success and the value proposition, all of a sudden I brought my entire class way up. But it also creates a different kind of learning community, right? So we really focus on this idea of engagement. And I guess you can tell my, so one of the things that we're realizing in the schools that we're working in, certainly we're changing curriculum, but it's not necessarily about changing the curriculum as much as it is changing our approach to the curriculum and how we engage students around the curriculum, right? There's no new discoveries about writing instruction, as far as I can tell, that come out this year, right? So we know how to do that. The question is, how do we create environments where our students want to do these things, right? That's going to make the difference in the achievement in your classroom, right? The engagement, right? Culturally relevant teaching, we'll talk about this. We talk about it in 3 ways, though. I mean, culture could be determined by ethnicity, culture could be determined by geography, culture could be determined by age. So culturally relevant is, how's it relevant to young people, right? How's it relevant to people in Illinois? How's it relevant across these multiple lines of difference? How do we begin to create curriculum that is relevant in those ways, right? How do we just weave in small lessons into the curriculum we've already developed that make that kind of difference? So in the schools where I've been working, one of the things we've done is not necessarily change the curriculum, but change the activities inside of the curriculum. So we take something that would have been an hour-long activity, and we break it up into 4 15-minute micro-activities. And for each of those activities, we have strategies for differentiation. We have ways of engaging students and ways of making it more socially, culturally, and technologically relevant. And that same curriculum is working. So it means some modifications, but it doesn't mean going back in July and thinking about throwing everything that I've done for the past 15 years out. It's sometimes just injecting a few micro-activities inside of that curriculum that really make those powerful connections, right? And that's, I think, a much easier task. Just going back at what we're doing and taking a little different slant at it. So in the remaining time I have, I'm going to share a bunch of examples. I tried to have an even number of examples in elementary and middle and secondary, but we do these same kinds of activities across the spectrum. If you have a question of, you see something that I did at the high school and you want to say, how does that look at the elementary school or vice versa, you can ask me and I'll tell you kind of how we adapted along the spectrum. So one of the first things we've been doing is, I see some other people do book ladders in here? Anyone do book ladders? Okay, well, let me explain it. Maybe I can sell it to you. So students need to do a lot more reading. And they need to be able to do more reading independently. That's an issue from elementary school through high school. One of the things you don't see in the core is a lot of, you must read this book. So we have used that to really expand our libraries. All the schools are expanding libraries, and there's very little of, you have to read this in the fifth grade, you have to read this in the eighth grade. It's just, read things that are sufficiently complex. So can we find things that are sufficiently complex that also interest kids? One of the ways to do that is to have a mix between books we read as a class and books that students read independently. So in Brooklyn, we've done these book ladder projects where basically this is a secondary one. So Monster, people know, it's a book that's targeted about at 7th grade, right? Dark Water, Voices from Within the Veil by Du Bois is a book that I would teach at Columbia. So we find interest bands for the kids. So this, someone look at this and tell me what you think the theme of this book ladder is. A hand, if you, because it has a title. We title them and we try to make them interesting. Anyone? Yes, in the back, right there. Okay, yep, Down These Mean Streets is the title of it. And Coming of Age in America, right? So Du Bois is like, yeah, I like that, right? I get to read Jay-Z. So we create these book ladders, and we've been doing them all spring. So we have ones that focus on young women, one that focus on friendship, ones that focus on family, ones that focus on New York City authors. You can do it in any kind of band. You can do like a 4-6. You can do a 7-9, you can do a K-3. So once the students finish and we have all sorts of close reading activities embedded in and they can read it as a group, we've been writing to publishers to try to get these books, and it's just been amazing how it's taken off. And so the kids are like, I can read this Down These Mean Streets. And we're only limited by how many teachers we have to be able to create these book ladders because they're so popular. Right? So that's one of the ways of kind of making it pop, and they want to read. So the principal at the one of the schools in Brooklyn, she's like, well, you can, you know, what are the criteria we have for making the argument about the complexity? So we have that. So we built this in, and this is one I did myself, and we go back and we revise it. One of the rewards for students is that as you go through the book ladder and you know the theme, you can suggest a text, and either A, you can just read that, or B, we might change the ladder. So the students are coming with their own proposal, and they're like, well, you know, I'd like to read a few more books by Puerto Rican authors. and here's a book, and this is why I think it's complex enough and why it builds on the last one. And we're like, okay, fine, that's fine. So the kids, even the younger kids, are already starting to think about how can I go out and look at other books, right? So there's so much dynamic reading material for kids. There's really no reason in an ELA curriculum to give them things that are boring. Really. There's really no reason to give them things that are boring because there's such freedom with the choice of the text because there are many texts that interest them at various levels of complexity. So that's one of the projects that we're doing. And I'd love if you do. That's my email at the bottom. I'd be happy to share the book ladders that we're creating. Bless you. If you do some. I'm trying to figure a way to use one of our NCTE sites so the teachers can begin to exchange the book ladders. And there's no reason why we should all have to reinvent the wheels on these things, right? So I'm trying to work on that, but in the meantime, we can do it artificially, and I can just show you the ones that we've put together. So we've also been doing a lot of reading comics and graphic novels. My 13-year-old son got a graphic novel assigned to him for his 8th-grade summer reading. He's going into the 8th grade. Him and mom went to the bookstore. I got home that afternoon, that book was done. It was actually one of the more complicated books that he had. He just sat down, because it had pictures in it, and it looked like this, and he didn't register that this is complicated, because it was a literacy that connected to him. A lot more teachers are signing graphic novels. Anyone in here signing graphic novels, have students? Great, yeah. And even like sharing those amongst each other, the students really like it. So we find ways to kind of connect that to some of the classical literature, but sometimes we just kind of teach it on its own. Close reading activities, right? I've seen a lot more of the close reading activities using high interest, high engagement, and I would also add shorter pieces. So I have this ratio in my mind for class activities. The more complex it is, the shorter chunk that I want to deal with. So when we're dealing with the most complex text, so I picked these two because it was in a school in New Jersey this week, where there were close reading activities around Machiavelli's The Prince and Swift's A Modest Proposal. And in one of them, you know, the kids, they actually had to create their own proposals and use satire, and they were pretty good at that. But this idea of eating babies was highly engaging to sophomores. You know, they're kind of reading it, and you know, satire is hard to get, so the teacher gave them no background, they had no idea, and so the kid's reading it, and he stopped in the sentence, he's like, are they eating the babies? And the kids got all into it, right? So they had a really close reading activity. One of the biggest differences I've seen, again this year, is we take something that was assumed, and we ask a question mark at the end, and the question is, what does it mean to read a text? Right, in my 20 years of teaching, it's not a question that I ask a lot. It's like we're reading Macbeth, right? We're reading, Humble Pie or something, whatever. But we don't. What does it mean to read it? As a class, individually. So, one of the things now it's meaning to read is to read it closely, right? Read it together. Read a paragraph. Take the group into a paragraph. Have them pull out ideas. Think about what the argument is here. What's the tone? How is the tone shifting? How can you, what are clues to the tone from the vocabulary? So they're getting in, I mean, satire is hard, right? Irony is hard, but, and I was pushing them, right, with the teacher. So it's kind of serious, but you know what's funny? How do you know that kind of stuff? And they were able to get into it because they were so interested in this idea that, is this man really serious? Did he go to jail? They're asking, Mr. Did he go to jail? Was he punished for this? How many babies did they eat, right? So at the end, they're kind of laughing and saying, wow, this is brilliant stuff. Like finding the most engaging chunk of the most engaging text that you can find that is complex but interesting for the grade level is a perfect opportunity to engage in those close reading activities. I think we're all doing pretty similar things now, right, with a small chunk and breaking up, asking questions. Sometimes they'll do it in writing. Sometimes they'll do it orally, that sort of thing. And the prince, right, and the especially the young boys, they love this idea. And what was it? The teacher just asked at the beginning, because they do a do now. I don't know if they do nows in Illinois, but it's kind of a writing warm-up activity the first 5 minutes of class. And they always write. They have these notebooks. So he has on the board, is it better to be feared or loved? And the kids are like, you know, and it's like, love, no fear, love. And he's like, well, we're going to read Machiavelli. Right? And so they're jumping into Machiavelli. And of course, Machiavelli is better to be feared. He's saying, you don't have to tell the truth if it doesn't serve your interest, right? And if someone is causing problems, better to get rid of them. And so, but at the same time, you know, this is the end of the year now, so we're getting the most complex text. At the end, they looked at him and said, the Prince is a really complex text. This was a 10th grade class. It's like a 12th grade text. And he said, it's the most complicated thing we've read all year. But you wouldn't have known it because the kids were so engaged over this, better to be feared than loved. They did these vocabulary activities, and I'll show you in a minute. We'll do like a 5 or 10 minute vocabulary warm-up activity. It may take a little bit longer with some of the words you know are going to be complicated in the text, so they're not spending time asking you, what does such and such mean? You've already done that. But finding small chunks of highly engaging, highly interesting, there's always something controversial that's in a magazine or something like that that you can have students reflect on, even into the elementary. So this is it, making the vocabulary pop. How many people are finding that you're having to do, since with more complex text, you're having to do more stuff with vocabulary, right? Yeah, I think that that's going to be the case across. And we've found that that's one of the differences that separates the text, right? The complexity is the vocabulary in it. So sometimes because it's archaic, sometimes because it's just not a part of the conversational vocabulary of the kids. So it's some of the literacy block has to be used for text-specific vocabulary development. And there's all sorts of really fun activities. I don't have time to go through a lot of them, but so we normally try to find not more than like 10 of the most difficult words, and we can do these in 10, 15 minutes if the kids can look them up. And so one class I was in, they have these teams. They work as teams. They have to pick the hardest word and come up with the funniest sentence that they can create about it. Or they have to pick the word that they thought was the most complicated, and they have to do a quick dramatic interpretation of it. And so there's just these little kind of make vocabulary pop activities that they'll do, and then they'll get into the reading. And one of the things I've noticed is very rarely is anyone stopping the teacher during the close reading activity saying, what does such and such mean? Because they've already gone through it. And they have those words in their notebooks. And it's much better than, you know, write it part of speech, use it in a sentence, and occasionally there's some of that, but we just try to do more fun activities and use the vocabulary development, and they like making weird sentences and even talking about the nuance of words and the connotations of words. And you know, in this class, if people wouldn't think about this particular school, this is one of the top 5 turnaround schools. The kids had a 2-minute conversation on the difference in the connotations between brevity and ephemeral. Before that was their reading, A Modest Proposal. So to get kids to read A Modest Proposal, have a conversation on the differences between brevity and ephemeral, right? I think that's exactly the kind of close reading and the kind of textual skills that we want kids to be developing. So I would think about that. What are short activities, a few words, make it a game to get kids talking about the vocabulary that they're going to see in a story that's going to be more complex around which their close reading activities. I think especially when there's that quick correlation between, I just saw that word, we had a conversation about it, and then boom, it's in the second paragraph of this piece I just read, right? Trying to do activities like that. Okay. Right, so I'll zoom through some more of these activities. I wanted to bring a bunch and show you a bunch, and as always the case, I get excited and start talking way too much about these activities that folks are doing. So one of the things that, though, we use this a lot, using drama. I just talked about one example of a response to reading. So having kids write plays, act out plays. This was a 4th grade group, and they were. This is a play that they wrote and were acting out around violence in the world. I mean, these kids did amazingly on their assessments. And so we like to use that a lot. One, it's good for them to get up and wiggle around and actually be rewarded for it. Talk. One of our issues this year was if speaking is a 21st century skill, how do we increase the quantity and quality of classroom talk? And so having them act out these plays was a way that we could do that and write them real quick. And, you know, writing on demand, which is another thing that we kind of secretly keep injecting more writing on demand, writing that you can't take home before someone else sees it, right? So like a play is kind of low status. And so we really had to pump that out. I don't want anybody to see this. But all the ways they're assessed and a lot of writing in 24, you have to write it and get it out to people. And so with the drama, they seem more willing to kind of do that stuff. So we would have them, whether it's vocabulary or interpretation of a particular aspect of, it doesn't even have to just be plays, right? It could be an essay, it could be a short story or a novel, having them do dramatic responses. And most of the time we make them write them out, you know, write out the scripts. Okay, mock trials, debates, Socratic conversations, we've been doing a lot more of that. You know, I was a part of a multi-year curriculum development project, and we really wanted to move from oral language development to academic writing. And it's always been my sneaking suspicion that if you could take an audio recorder to your kids and record what they were able to say, it would rate much higher than what they write. Even though, if you played back the recorder, they could write down every word that they said. Right? So when I first started teaching, I was like, I have met very few kids in my 20 years that can't write down every word they can say. And if you can say it, how come you can't write it? And that became so how do I get them in touch with all of the complexity in their oral language so that you see more of that in the writing? So they'd have this 10-minute conversation, then write you two sentences, right? Am I the only person that's had that? Right? Yeah, a 10-minute conversation, two sentences. Like, come on now, right? Like what you just said. So we've been trying to do that more, increasing the quality and quantity of talk and having them aware that this speech is rich. Write down notes, right, when someone else is speaking, and just moving from their very rich, very vibrant oral tradition to a writing tradition. So our Socratic circles have done that. Our mock trials and our debates are ways that we've done that. So the last couple of examples I'll use is how we've been injecting more media into the curricula across the spectrum. And this the piece, The Critical Media Pedagogy, that's a book that I just finished with a couple of teachers, and I think it just came out about a month ago. Right. So using media in the 21st century classroom, being able to read the media, you're seeing that a lot more in the curriculum that's coming to you, right, where they have these multimodal components or online components, being able to look at magazine articles, smart boards. The schools are having, folks having smart boards installed in classrooms now. So I'm seeing that a lot. It will happen next couple years. So showing a little clip of something, right, for 2 minutes on the smart board, and how do you read these media? So these are questions that we ask. We'll vary these questions across the spectrum, but as kids are reading the media, kind of what does it mean to be normal or cool? What does it mean to be uncool? What messages are being sent to you? Those sorts of things. So the average kid encounters millions of these kinds of images in her lifetime. So, you know, when you think about the intersection of media, literacy, social-emotional learning, identity, it's all together, right? We have fifth grade girls that are starving themselves for more than 24 hours because they're concerned about their body image, right? We have boys in elementary school, middle school that are in brutal fights over shoes and, you know, things like that. So having a curriculum that both increases academic performance but that also helps kids with this real life ability to decode the images. So right now on summer break, it's, you know, maybe your kids aren't up yet, but by the time they get up and have lunch and then dinner, they will have seen hundreds of these kinds of images just today, right? So how do we develop activities? How do we develop language? How do we develop curricula inside of our literacy-based units that are helping them to be able to relate? And these, even though they may seem intended for larger audiences, upper elementary kids are encountering images like this on a daily basis. So we ask questions, what does it mean to be normal? What does it mean to be cool? What is this saying about what it means to be a man? And also the visual literacy that's associated with this, right? So we just took 2 minutes, and let's do the fitty one, right? And as the boys will notice, since it's targeted towards boys, there's no words on it, right? The one that's targeted towards girls is kind of like cluttered with words, and it's like, the only word up there is redundant because you would have to be from Mars not to know who this man is, right, if you were a kid in America today. So as in a visual literacy paradigm, how, because we know what image it's connoting, how is it connoting that image? You see a couple hands, right? So how does this picture convey a certain image? Yes? Yeah, it's huge, right? It's the size of his head. So it would basically be like Fetty holding a cannon in his hand, right, if you look at the size of it. So we can talk about the focal point. And with Hayden Panettiere, the focal point of that picture is in two places, right? What is it? Yeah, it's actually perfect. It's the point between her bosom and her smile. So the kids will understand that kind of stuff, right? The focal point, the bling and the gun and the mean mug are in a triangle there, right? The same way that the triangle space in 17 Magazine has no words in it. There are no words to cover her, the kids call it a come hither look, and her bosom, right? All the words around it are words that you don't want your 11 or 12-year-old girl to be thinking about anyways, right? Pretty, sexy, get the guy, spring shopping spree, all those sorts of things. Right? So we help them understand how to read these media. We also use this in a curriculum where they begin to write their own media, right? Where they use technologies, and so we talk about creating your own counter media campaign and that sort of thing in elementary school all the way up through high school. But this becomes a really important skill that kids are going to need to develop, and we're going to need to figure out how to inject it. It's high excitement, but it's also highly relevant. So we do a lot with the poetry and kind of connecting poetry to contemporary music. I won't talk so much about that. We're using the flip cams, having young people make PSAs and digital films, embedding films in PowerPoint presentations. We can put these together in a few minutes on a netbook or in the library, even in classrooms that don't have a lot of computers. The last thing I'll talk about is youth research, right? So this idea of creating knowledge, what's the skill set you need to go and get more information about a topic and be able to come up with a legitimate argument about that topic based on the sources that you've accumulated, I think is a good way to sum up the huge change in writing instruction across the K-12, right? That you gotta be able to go, first of all, you're inundated with information, right? So how do you find a trusted source? How do you read that source critically? How do you know that you've gotten all the differing opinions, right? So our question has not been, how do we teach youth research? Because there's no question that we're teaching youth research at every level. Our question has been, how do we center youth research in things that matter to the students? And how can we give a little more gravitas and status to the projects that they're doing? So I'll talk a little bit about that. You can see, you know, these pictures where we've actually had students, you know, all dressed up and speaking to the mayor, or bringing in, you know, high-level officials and community citizens, or parent night, or those sorts of things. That once the kids collect this information, there should be places for them to share it. There's online blogs and that sort of thing that we've taken advantage of too. So I love this quote by Carl Sagan. One of the things that's highly relevant about research is it taps into a natural curiosity. My 18-month-old is involved in several research projects every day, right? Some of them turn out better than others for him or for us, right? But it's a natural curiosity. If I do this, will this happen, right? And every discipline has its own form of research, right? Where you're asking questions. What is that last? A few trickle through the system with their wonder and enthusiasm for science intact, right? So how do we tap into that natural curiosity when we're developing our research projects? And how do we create appropriate venues on the back end of the research projects? I think makes all the difference. So the kind of things that teachers are doing in the middle seem to me mostly the same, right? Identify your sources. An activity on in-text citations, they sound familiar, right? How do you tell a credible source from a non-credible source? Once you synthesize your sources, how do you want to revise your hypothesis? All those sorts of things, which are great activities. But I argue, what makes the research project pop are the topics they get to choose and what they do with it on the back end, right? That's where we're making the difference. So these questions that we ask, if you could change the world, what's one thing you would do? If you could change your community, what's the one thing you would change? And so we're asking the students these kinds of questions, and so they're looking at everything from the criminal justice system, to transportation, to environmental awareness, and this is, like I said, elementary all the way up. And they are really excited about this stuff. Anti-bullying measures, you know, what are the schools and you know, in the area that have the best anti-bullying programs, and what could we do to create an anti-bullying program on our campus? So when we situate the research in world-changing, the excitement goes way up. And even around literature, right? So some of these are come out of novel studies. But at the end of that, so you read 11th grade, you read A Great Gatsby, or you're in the 7th grade, you read A House on Mongo Street. You read, I don't know when people read, like the Watsons go to Birmingham, that sort of thing. But you could think of all sorts of research projects on the back end, right? So I'll show you one we did with third graders around civil rights. And so we really try to connect it to something that's powerful, that's meaningful to them, and that is real research, that, that the knowledge can contribute to something. There's a lot of ways that that the research component is in the Common Core, so I won't necessarily talk about that. But this process is really important for us because a lot of times we'll just work in the middle of this. We don't necessarily have the time to help kids identify a problem. Even at the graduate level, when my students are doing dissertations, we don't start with a question, we start with a problem. When you start with a problem, research makes a lot more sense. If you start with a question, it kind of seems like you're just picking it from somewhere, right? So we say, what's the problem that you care about? The problem I care about is that it's very difficult for anyone in my neighborhood to get around because the buses don't come on time. When they see us at the bus stop, they drive away. That was a question that fueled an entire cross-disciplinary year-long curriculum project in Boston that ended with the principal being in tears saying it's the most amazing thing he's seen in 25 years. They identified a problem that mattered to them. They ended up the history of transportation and residential segregation in the city and all this sort of, but they started with a problem, right? Einstein said if there weren't problems or things that we didn't know enough about, there would be no need for research. So when research is not connected with a problem or curiosity, it kind of loses some of its mojo, right? So developing a question, figuring out how to do the study, collecting the data, making claims, providing evidence. So then we come to 8, 9, and 10. What are the products that are associated with your research paper? So yeah, it's the paper, but maybe it's also a 5-slide PowerPoint that the kids are going to do in some kind of an academic festival. Maybe it's submitting to an internal blog that everyone in the school is reading, or the school paper, or whatever. But what are the products that we can create as a result of this research that give it some value? Maybe it's just orally doing a quick presentation to the parents or the rest of the staff on the work that you've done. But those kinds of things really matter. This is one of the schools, a different school in New Jersey, and the principal's very happy. People know Miri Baraka, the poet, familiar with him. Leroy Jones, Black Arts Movement. This is his son. Ras Baraka is a principal in New Jersey. He's happy because he doubled the graduation rate at the school in 5 years. I'd be happy too, right? And one of the things that they do at this school that I worked with them on last year is an autoethnography project. It's basically myself, my community, my world project, right? If I was doing it with younger kids like we have, that's what we would call it. We wouldn't use autoethnography because that's a pretty complicated term. But it's basically using multiple genres and modes to tell the story of your life. So with the myself, a lot of it is poetry and narrative. Kind of what makes me tick, my environment, kind of day in my life, that sort of thing. The my community is more like journalistic or qualitative, interactional. How do I connect with folks in my community? And the my world is more quantitative, sociological. How is my life affected by larger factors? And so we had this project in the kids did a multiple page project and multiple mode project, and some of it's pictures and images, and some of it is text, and some of it is narrative, and some of it is more argumentative or research based. But this became a rite of passage of the school. And I think that at upper elementary, middle school, and this was early high school, those sorts of projects are really powerful. The students, so sometimes they ask a question. Oh, I thought I lost my microphone. Sometimes they ask a question about their neighborhoods that they want to start and relate themselves, their community. Sometimes it really starts more with them thinking about themselves and the questions come out of that. Like, how did my family arrive here? One group asked about residential segregation. They said, how come everyone on one side of the river looks different than everyone on the other side of the river? And so they begin to do these stories about themselves and transition and interviewing parents and community members and figuring that out and looking at employment patterns and subways and highways and these sorts of things. And so they did these projects about themselves. They learned a lot about themselves and how their community was formed, good and bad. So it's become a really powerful way for students to merge the act of research with learning about themselves. Because a lot of times research is about learning about others, and Mike has heard me talk about this, that, you know, we seem more interested in kids learning about Mesopotamia than their own block. Right, in New York, we've created this whole curriculum around New York authors, New York history, and I shared a little bit of that before. And so research can be learning about yourself. It can be learning about your neighborhood, learning about your family. And so that's an important way of really getting them hooked on research and not just starting with these really distance topics, but starting with things that are more proximal for them. A Day in My Life is a part of that project I talked about where we have students write about a day in their lives and begin to share that. That can be just its own activity, or it can be part of the larger Myself, My Community, My World project. This is a blog that some of the kids created after they did their autoethnographies. It's a Young Critical Minds website. The last thing I'll say, run through, is so we do also work connecting language arts, science, and social science around projects of oral history, having kids do interview people in their community, learning more about their neighborhood. This is our project that we do in Harlem, where it's a youth historians project. We're actually working with some historians from the college are helping the kids. The kids are asking for access to archives. The local libraries are connected. And the students are really excited about learning about their neighborhood. At the same time, we're designing the book ladder projects around local authors. So they're reading these local authors, and you could certainly do that. You know, Illinois has enough of a cadre of authors to do that kind of work. So they're doing the history work, the oral history, looking at archives, reading literature. It's a very rich kind of reading and writing environment, but it's also very much centered in them learning more about themselves, right? It's been very positive, the response, both from the teachers, from the community members and family members that are interviewed, and from the students themselves. Okay, this is an example we did with Bless Me Ultima. So the last thing I'll show you is how we created a research project around a book. These are the kids, third graders. So this was a piece of literature, the story of Ruby Bridges. People read this? Yeah, good. So we did it, and so the research project out of it for the students were, are things better or worse today? Based 50 years after the Civil Rights Movement, this incident. And so this is a project, and so these kids did these research projects, and actually we brought them together in a room about this size, kids from 5 or maybe more like 10 different schools, and they presented their research projects to each other, 3rd, 4th, and 5th graders. And this is their PowerPoint slide. These are their slides. So this is some of the research that they did. A young girl in 3rd grade, and she presented this. So they begin by doing research on their own campus. And seeing what life was like on their campus. They did interviews, they did campus observation, they went to other neighborhood schools, and when they couldn't make it to the other neighborhood schools, they looked them up online and used the pictures from the schools to kind of talk about some of the differences between schools they attended in a highly impoverished neighborhood in Southern California and some of the schools in surrounding suburbs. So they wrote these letters. Mr. H is the superintendent. So then they know terms like oral history, right? So they wanted to interview people who were alive during the Civil Rights Movement or before about what it was like to live when segregation was mandated. And so they asked, they developed their own interview protocols to do this kind of work. I love this one. Our schools and rich schools. Grass, clean bathrooms. And they said, well, good teachers, we both have good teachers, yeah. Raggedy food, dirty bathrooms, and no grass. And they talked about their methodology for doing this kind of, like, school visits and then internet searches for what the schools look like in their neighborhood. And then they wrote a play, right, where they dramatized this. So they had their PowerPoint, they had their research report, their oral history, and their play. These students did amazingly, and the teacher and their test scores, they led their sub-district in test scores for several years, and these students had been in a pipeline for a project I ran for 12 years in LA, that went, now those first students are sophomores in college. At the 12th grade level, there was 100% graduation rate. We ran that project, 12 years we had 100% graduation rate of the students that were involved. And these were in schools that had high school graduation rates that were more in the 40s or 50 percentile. So the last thing I want to show is an example of a speech that a young girl's given after she's done some research on the impact of budget cuts at her school. And then I'll open it up for questions. So a little bit of context. One of the things we did in these elementary schools is we went through these units together, and they cycled through kind of from, it was very much a social-emotional learning curriculum. It was also literacy. So the first part of the year was always understanding myself, understanding others, conflict resolution. And the final six-week chunk was freedom and democracy. So they had to investigate some project, do research, and they had to make these freedom and democracy speeches in their classroom, and they selected the best from their classrooms, and they kind of made them for the school. So every year from kindergarten all the way up through fifth or sixth grade, this school was in danger of being taken over by the state of California. This was a Northern California school when the team arrived to do this kind of work. And now they outperform the district average. I was just out there in February or March, and the school is still doing amazing. They're still outperforming the state and district averages. You'll see why in this young fourth grader, Angel Chen. She talks about the research that she's done, but you can see her sophistication and the kind of skill set that she's developing as a part of being in this curriculum where they're cultivating young people's voices and they're also having them do their own research.
Hello. Hello. My name is Angel Chen, and I'll be talking about budget cuts. Would you like to have old, broken-down books year after year? I wouldn't. The money schools receive from the government and our state government will be reduced due to education budget cuts. If we don't do anything to prevent the government from cutting money from schools, essential programs in our school might not exist. These programs include art classes, music lessons, cooking classes, etc. Even our school supplies could be minimized. Class sizes may increase, which would cause some teachers to lose their jobs. Budget cuts not only affect students and teachers, but also many people. It influences you and I and our entire city. Without the right supplies, programs, and teachers, students won't get the best education. Without a good education, students won't get the best jobs and will have low pay. They might need to steal to survive in this society. The number of troublemakers will increase, so more prison cells may be needed. The state will get the money to build those prisons from our education. Do you think this is fair? I say no.
All right. All right. Yeah, I always want to like wear a button that says Angel for President, right? And I'm hearing her making that speech. And there are many like that. So I'll end by saying this. Like I said, you know, I come from three generations of educators, right? And we've seen a lot of moments in those three generations of education. Listen to my parents tell their oral history of all the end of days movements that they've encountered in their 90 plus combined years of education. One thing hasn't changed. Classrooms where kids are excited. And classrooms where kids are highly engaged and motivated and feel good about themselves are better classrooms. The only things that change for us really is how we answer those questions about how to excite kids and how to have them believe in themselves in the new context. So we know that the context has changed. It's more multimodal, it's more interactive, it's very different than the 20th century model. But I'm confident that we will do this. Right, that it is not asking us in any way I can see to fundamentally change our values about what matters. I like the Japanese concept of Kaizen. It's continual improvement. Right, it's not a cycle of broken and fixed, and that induces a lot of stress and anxiety. It's just how do we continually improve? How do we continue to adapt? How do we make our literacy classrooms more responsive to the changing environment? And when we do that, and we continue to ask those questions about getting the most of our students, the most excited, most of the time, good things happen. Right? So I'm happy to answer questions, but I just want to end by thanking you for coming at the beginning of your summer. Thank you for being here over four days. And most importantly, I don't think we thank teachers enough. I mean, thank you for what you do for kids. I mean, my dad said, you know, teaching makes you eternal, right? It's just, you never know when that gift stops giving, right? And he gets Facebooked from kids that he taught in the late 60s, and they tell him how they still remember the impact he's had on their life. Like, raise your hand if you can remember the name of your first, second, or third grade teacher. Right, look around. Okay, you can put your hands down. They will remember you, right? What other profession can say that, right? You are, unfortunately, considerably older now than you were in the first second. And on your deathbed, you will remember these people. Right? I don't know that there's another profession that can say that, right? The impact that we have on the lives of young people. So on behalf of the profession, thank you for what you're doing, and thank you for what you will continue to do for our kids.
Yes.
Hello?
Ooh, there we go. Get the right button.
My question is this.
Yes.
I think the book ladder is really a great idea. My question is, where do you find these books? And what kind of activities do you use for these books?
Okay, thank you. So let me do the second part first. So one of the things that we thought was really important in breaking down our assumptions as a teacher team was that that kids can read as complex a text on their own as they can in class. Right? So a lot of times we operate under the assumption you can read it in class, you can read it at home, but we know that's not the case, right? That there has to be scaffolds to help kids read. So the activities, we try to have 5 to 10 minute activities that work for all the kids regardless of what books they're reading. Everything from how do you derive the meaning of words from context clues that you don't understand, to what's an appropriate way to respond early in the book, how do you make predictions about what's going to happen? We try to get a treasure chest of these 5 to 10 minute activities. When I was in Los Angeles, one of my graduate students did his dissertation on collecting 5 to 10 minute activities that they could use across the school in their independent reading period that were taught by kids to other kids. So some of it is becoming aware of your own strategies as a reader, learning what other strategies are for reading, thinking about writing responses that help you with comprehension, vocabulary development exercises. I mean, they fall into those categories, but we basically try to not have them be too long, but really helping put those scaffolds in place. Now, on the back end, the activities are what you might expect, from more exciting ways to do a book report to if you had to turn your book into a movie, what might you do? Or if you had to write a book review for the school literary magazine or a local classroom blog, get up and do a 2-minute pitch for your book, but don't give away the ending, those sorts of things. So the back end is more like what we've been doing. But the beginning and middle is we're trying to build up, one, the reading stamina, and two, the independent reading that students are able to do. They still won't be able to do it the same as in a classroom where they can ask you, and you go, oh, now I get it. But what kind of activities can we put in to help students become aware of the fact that they are reading strategies and that they're getting more of them? So I could talk to you more offline about what those strategies are, how they're developed, but we're always trying to find more. What I can say for sure is the time frame. We like them to be about 5 minutes long. And we like to have them, you know, a couple times a week for students to begin to have this repertoire of activities that they can use as they get through the books. Sometimes the students will read those books from the book ladders in small groups, and we'll have prompts for them. You know, what was the most exciting passage that you read and why? And they would point to a passage and talk about that passage, things like that. What was the most difficult passage that you read? Those sorts of things.
Yeah. Coming.
Your book?
Yes. Yeah, sure. So we, it's right there. So we started as a collaborative inquiry project with teachers. So one of the things that I'll do with the school sites is at the very beginning of the year, say, what are our big questions? Or some of them, since I've been working with for many years, they're asking them now at the beginning of the summer. So for this particular group, their question was, how do we inject more media and popular culture into our content-based curriculum? So that was the question that we started with. And it ended up being a 5-year project that led to a book. And they're still doing this work. I mean, these teachers are amazing teachers. They're in Southern California. One of the things is, I think it makes the argument for how a media literacy is no longer something that's extra or tangential. You know, when I first started, I was competing, and I was a coach, so I'm not knocking coach. I am a coach, I'm not knocking coaches, but The VCR was something that the PE coach rolled in when he had to substitute for the social studies teacher, right? And that was kind of the way people thought about media. Oh, here comes the gym teacher, you know, pushing the video card again. So it was seen as, this is way too fun to be educational, right? It's not as serious as reading Hamlet. So how do we make that argument that this is not an add-on, it's central to the curriculum, right? And then what does it even mean to have a media literacy today? How do we weave that in? So you see that's, you know, it's in the core, it's going to be even more in the standards. It's in the College Board standards. You know, they're thinking about how to adapt for that in the AP test. It's certainly at the university level. So the university, you know, there's a lot of media in classrooms. So this idea that we are in a media age. So to be literate in the media age, by definition, means to have a media literacy. And that has to be given as much status and stature as other forms of literacy. Think about it, in 1890, to be literate would mean when you graduated high school, you could translate Homer from the Greek, right? And then that went away, right? Not too many people are translating Homer from the Greek, I think, anymore in English class or in their literary classes. So literacies change, they evolve. The literacy in the 21st century is gonna be partly media. But the rest of it is really looking at how that begins to take shape in the lives of these classrooms. And how teachers started with this question, how they developed units, what they did in those units, and what they learned from them. So we're really trying to make an argument that that this is not, we don't need to think about an extra media class as much as we need to think about how to authentically integrate media into our content area classrooms, so that it becomes a natural part of classroom life. At the end, you know, we talk a little bit about resources and the kind of things you need, which I see a lot of districts are moving toward. I work with some districts that are really, you know, in under-resourced communities, and they're becoming able to access these technologies. So that's really what it's about. Yes. Yeah, I mean, it's more kind of a compilation of things that I've read and done. I can talk about it briefly. So one of the things that, I'm looking for my whiteboard, there's no whiteboard. So we think about cultures, right? We put cultures in the center. Imagine that you're gonna have, a bubble and five things coming out. So when we think about cultures and what is a part of all cultures, that would be important to replicate in a classroom or school culture. The first is rewards, right? So we think about what are the rewards that we build into this? The second is consequences. The third is explanations. The fourth, scaffolds and or structures, resources. And the fifth, norms. So when we think about some of these, so it could be, you could put whatever you want in, but we'll do some classroom ones. So we have this independent reading one, right, that led to the Book Ladders Project. Because we have to think about what are the rewards that we want to have in place, and we weren't allowed to use grades. What are other rewards? Getting to read things that interest you, right? Being able to share your information and having the status as a knower, that sort of thing, right? And we'd always come to consequences last, right? So then we would go to, what are the explanations or scaffolds that we need? And that's when we came, so to answer your question about the activities, we realized that it wasn't so much that the kids didn't want to read, but they didn't have a skill set to read on their own the way they could read in class, so they just gave up reading on their own. You know, there's nothing more frustrating than sitting home at night reading 2 pages into a book and feeling ignorant because you can't get through it. So we needed to change our explanations. And this happens in all sorts of cultures outside of, you know, school and how you learn to be you, how you learn to cook or sew or ride a bike or those sorts of things. It's short, brief, context-specific explanations. And then we need to think about what are the resources or scaffolds or structures that we need to have in place within classrooms, across classrooms. So a note to parents about how much reading to expect per night became part of that. Having more time and space in class for students to read the text of their choosing. And so it's kind of what do we make normal? Now we have a larger structure for things that we do in terms of a school climate, but it all builds into that, right? So then out of that, we would go to the resources we need. So a question we ask always is, what does it look like? What should it look like when it's good or excellent? And then 2 questions about how do we know? What information can we collect from what we're doing to help us know whether we got it or we're getting it? And the other, which I think was pointing to your question, what information do we need to access to get smarter about this? And so we would meet in our common planning times during the day, periodically, some of the places weekly, some of the places less frequently. They could meet more often. They would schedule in that time for teachers to work together. And we'd constantly be asking the question, well, let's look at our practice or our work and see what evidence we can find in there of where we're going. That would also bring up questions about what other information do we need? So if there was a framework and someone would say, well, let's look at Danielson, right? So there's all these things that we read, but I don't ever go in saying, you should read this, right? We go in and say, well, what are the questions, right? To get even better than you already are because you're rock stars, right? What do we need to do, right, to get better? And so we get used to asking that question, how can I be better today? Like, what do I need to do? And for the purposes of common planning across a grade level or a department or a school, we try to have a central question. I think our question next year is really going to be a reading question across most of the schools about close reading and complex text and how to help students to be better at that. This year it was a writing question. It's really about getting kids to writing and the research writing. We're still going to do that. But really, anything you put in that bubble, I think you would have a really rich conversation if you started thinking about the rewards, the consequences, explanations, scaffolds, and norms. Yep?
My question is about, you were referring to the motivation of the kids and the focusing on the ones that felt like that they can't mm-hmm. or they won't, and then the identity. Mm-hmm. And changing the identity or their belief system in themselves.
Yes.
Do you think that there's a way to measure that cognitive shift?
Yeah, so in my research, we look at 3 outcomes. One is literacy, one is identity, and the other one is more kind of their production. A couple of ways that I would look at it, so there's self-report research. Right, where, so one of the classes, for instance, the kids at the beginning of their they do a literacy autobiography where they talk about their experiences with literacy. And some of them end up talking about really more traumatic experiences. So there becomes an ongoing conversation about their relationship to literacy. So you can get some of the identity information from self-report, just asking them. The other is how we can measure engagement, affect, body language. So we're big on body language as an expression of identity in the classroom. So I'll talk to kids about, you know, kids who I only know by the top of their head, because that's all I see. Or sometimes I see an ear, and I'm like, oh, you've got eyes too, right? Because I never see them in class. We talk about the kind of like this look. And so with teachers, we talk about talking kids into the tiger crouch. And so in the schools I work, kids know I come in a classroom. They jump into the tiger crouch. The other is in particular activities, right? So students that are really reticent to take the lead or to speak. So there might be a Socratic or a conversation that you have, and you look at who's taking the turns and how often they're speaking, all those sorts of things. So they're more informal measures that you can really look at. I would do the self-report, have metacognitive or meta-reflective components of your assignments where the kids are asked to reflect on the process and how they feel about themselves, so you get that kind of information. But I definitely will look at body affect, turn taking, those sorts of things. But part of the fun part of it is not even going with the traditional research, but figuring out the measures as a faculty. Like, we spend a lot of time saying, how will we know when we got there? Because right. That's important, right?
Right?
So I say, Labor Day, we come in with the best of intentions, right? Labor Day is always filled with great intentions for educators. So I want to know, at Halloween, how do we know where we are, right? At Thanksgiving, at Christmas break, Valentine's Day, right? And thinking about formative measures, but also as we observe the classroom, right? Some folks will look at attendance measures for the older kids. And so increased attendance, increased homework handing in. So with one of our schools, the teachers, they really, what percentage of students are handing in the homework on time is another measure that they use, that they're willing to do this. So there's all sorts of things, but I think some of it is looking at what others are doing, but really it's being creative and thinking about from our school and our location, if we want to measure a change in identity, what are some of the things that we should be looking for?
Do you personally feel like that you can tell when a child has made that cognitive shift in identity to believing that they can?
You're talking about a life change. So what we try to look at, we have one formula, is change over time. So I think we have to think about what would be a reasonable change in like 6 weeks, if I'm talking about that 6 week period, or even over the year. So to see a shift may be a larger increment in time than the academic year. But certainly you want to be able to see changes, right? And I can see a kid who was unwilling to read be willing to read and volunteer to read. I can see a kid who in a group like this would never say a word. I see them talking now, right? I see them raising their hand. A kid who wasn't ever handing in homework. A kid who would not do on-demand writing. So in their 5 to 7 minute writing, I look at that, like they're writing more. And then in having that time for them to reflect in the units, I can see a difference in their reflections, how they talk about it. So I definitely think you want to be able to identify changes over time, but even if it may not be a fundamental shift that happens, you'll be able to see some changes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
You talked about two different pieces of this, the motivation piece that she was asking about, if it can be measured, and this sort of critical media pedagogy. Uh-huh. Do you teach those as separate entities? Do you teach something like an efficacy program to the students to create that motivation and then move into this type of teaching, or do you use this type of teaching to create that motivation, or is it both, kind of a chicken or an egg?
Okay, so you mean and work with at the school level or work with the students themselves?
Mostly with the student themselves, but I imagine that teachers need some of that motivation and belief that they can too.
Yeah, so with the students, well, I think the difference is which one would be the chicken or the egg. So with the students, we cut right to the chase, right? And having them talk about why they don't believe in themselves, right? And so it's really making that evident. With the teachers, the way that these changing identities become reinforced is to create learning communities where there's an expectation of success and where there's relevancy. One of the things that would happen is you get students to buy in a little bit initially, but that buy-in has to be reinforced by success. And we're torn because our external success is determined largely by standardized measures, which by definition don't allow a definition of success for everyone. So sometimes that gets passed on to the students, and the students will interpret that as meaning there's no way I can be successful. So I use metaphors from coaching a lot when I talk with the students. I've coached for 20 years, and I coach athletes across a wide range of abilities. And one of the things that I yell at my athletes all the time is that I am an effort person, not an ability person. Effort gets rewarded on my team, not ability. And it's hard because that contradicts in the school system sometimes. Like a kid who has ability might get rewarded more than a kid who puts effort in. When we think about grades or other kinds of that, answer the woman's question over here about how do you change the culture, what are rewards that I can put in the place in my learning culture that reward effort, right? And then that bolsters. So it is a little bit of a chicken and the egg. I do think that students need to confront their anxieties about academic life, and that has to be a really explicit part of curriculum and work with them, because anxiety is so much a part of it. Whether it's reading complex text for the first time, if you don't have that explicit conversation of how many people read the first page of this book at home and felt totally stupid, and they raised their hand and like, okay, it's all right. Right? So you're having a little bit of that efficacy conversation. But at the same time, with teachers, we're really trying to ramp it up and think about how do we create a culture where there's the expectation of success and relevancy at the same time. Am I over? Okay. Right. Is everyone totally exhausted? Oh, yes.
Can't hear behind you.
If they're required on the book ladders, yeah. The whole list of, you know, we try to get more motivating and engaging books.
Yeah.
And sometimes the school board says, well, you know, it's a little too much. You know, did you have to get all those approved, or they were optional books for the kids so you didn't have to? I know if they're required.
That's a great question. We, at least at the level of the school, right, so they have to go through the principal and the department, and we have to establish protocols. This is something that we're also working on a lot this year because, quite frankly, in my 20 years, I've never seen a moment where people were so willing to bring new text in as now. Because, you know, I spent part of the summer last summer looking at the Common Core at the College Board. And it was teachers all over the country, and they wanted our take on it. And one of the first things we noticed is, it's not telling us what to read. So does that mean we could really teach anything that, yeah, we could. So, but now everyone's trying to get these protocols in place, right? And so I'd love to hear different stories about how that's happening, how it's taking shape. We're trying to get books approved, at least at the school level, so that the teachers all know what each other is teaching, that we have some way of dealing with that, some way of pointing out if there are issues that should be flagged. Certainly, it's been the case with the YA and the children's lit for some time. Even in approved books, they're very sensitive issues. And how do we kind of help students through that instead of hiding those books from them? Do we have strategies for doing that? What are the explanations for why certain books are taught for parents? But quite honestly, we're just at the very beginning of that. And some of that is coming up. Right now, we've taken a very conservative notion that the principal says, you can't teach that. I'm like, maybe you're right. But I'd love to have a more kind of sophisticated way of thinking about how we do that, because the book ladders, and most people are doing this independent reading stuff, it's going to exponentially expand the number of books that we're responsible for. So now the teachers, all summer we're reading all these books in each other's book ladders so that we can at least come back and be conversant with 200 books, which is crazy, but you're going to have a number like that, right, of books if you start something like this. Yes?
In terms of the amount of work that's done for grades as opposed to, you know, just trying is how does this work with the Common Core goal for college and career readiness, where evaluation is the name of the game?
Yep. Well, I mean, the number one assumption that we operate under is that an excited and engaged kid is doing more work. right? So in these schools, they have raised achievement. I mean, the achievement is increasing. And I argue that it is because the kids are excited. So one of the things that we do with superintendents a lot is we'll walk through schools. And what you begin to see is there are varying degrees of disengagement of students. So it's not that, you know, are we replacing something that was standards-based, that everyone loved and was involved in and succeeding on, or is it just over their heads or unappealing to them? Right? I mean, this is Jeffrey Wilhelm's argument. Just get the kids to open a book, right? And then they'll be much more inclined to read the things you want them to read. So it hasn't been as hard a sell as I thought it was going to be around the country in the places where I've worked. We have certainly, you know, at any moment you can stop, boom, and say, what's going on here and how does it correlate to what we think about quality literacy instruction? And we should be able to stop any nanosecond and tell you what's happening and why. But the main idea is to get, well, I think they're the two main ideas, to get kids more excited, more engaged, but also much more confident about what they're doing. So how do we break things down? How do we make them appealing? We found, I mean, it's been so humbling that coming to the realization that our explanations were missing kids. And that the assumptions we had when we said to do something that weren't assumptions that the kids held. And so it wasn't transforming and throwing out all of our old curriculum and getting new curriculum as much as was going inside of that. And now you even hear the assistant principal or, you know, the head of English Language Arts for the district saying, we got to get those kids talking to each other. We got to get them excited in the classroom. So I think it's catching on. But I think we also have to be able to pull together our own measures to get back to the question over here about identity. And we do a lot of that. How do we own some of this assessment conversation within our district? How do we know that kids are learning? It's not like opening up the test scores like a Christmas present and seeing, is it, you know, a lump of coal or, you know, candy. How do we know? And, you know, to be quite honest, and there with the changing assessments, I mean, there's a lot of uncertainty. And with some of the early benchmarks that one of the districts is trying to create around the Common Core, there was some ambiguity over whether or not there was improvement. But the teachers do such good work, and they have such great portfolios of the work that the superintendent wasn't concerned at all. He's like, I know these kids are learning, right? And as long as they continue learning, we're gonna see that evidenced on the test. So I think that, but I think we have to begin to do those things and always have that why conversation, and connect the why of engagement and excitement and motivation to student production and student learning. Thank you.